Hi, so quick intro. I'm Paul and I have lived here 11 years now and I do a lot of work in fish, but I'm a sort of a micro world kind of guy. So I look at very particular things in ichthyology, certain fish species, life history, and this in a way was an interesting challenge for me because it was a reason to pause and look at the big picture, which I rarely do. And this whole climate change thing is something that's going on here, and having been so caught up in my own thing, I haven't frankly given it the thought that it deserves, I would say. So with that, my talk is about how climate change can impact the northern fish communities. So up here in the north, we have many fish species. It's not as fish rich as down south, where, for example, in the Great Lakes, you have over hundreds of species. Here we have barely 50, and I just wanted to give you a breakdown about how many of them use lake environments versus river environments, and we also have some anadromous species that come and go during their life history from marine environment into freshwater. So climate change effects, as most of you know, are very pronounced in Canada's north. It's very obvious and very easy to see and measure. Things like sea temperature rises or erosion, and even our degradation of permafrost. In this case, we have discontinuous permafrost that's also decreasing. The summer discharge, so lesser flows in streams. These are all obvious primary impacts. And with that being said, concerning the cause and effect, it's the secondary impacts in the areas of fish biology that I want to concentrate on and give you examples of. Those, of course, are a little more, well, they're not so obvious. They're more difficult to assess, per se. So a little summary about the loss and gains in a world that's warming up. You can see the black arrows indicate decrease, and the white arrows are an increase. And these are sort of the ABCs of climate change that are, of course, even more pronounced in our northern or subarctic environment that I happen to be working in. The trends overall worldwide, I like this one because it starts with 1965 and I was born a year later, so you can see the trends and the areas where the warming is more pronounced or most pronounced are of course up in areas where I happen to be working and living now. So what can we expect in the next while? There's going to be shifts in migrating fish species that are colonizing areas. Now, there is a natural trend between ice ages of these things, but of course, now this is more pronounced and speeded up. The future vulnerabilities of those populations from outside and local threats is going to be more pronounced, and changes in local abundance of community important species. And I want to stress this because when it comes to climate change and fish, I still need to talk a bit about how people who have a history of dependence on certain species or abundance of some fish will be impacted. And then, of course, the freshwater, anadromous marine fishes that were limited to a typically more southern distribution are now colonizing the Arctic, especially the Western Arctic. So when I looked at the handout that was given to us about what we need to address for our talk, I noticed that feedback was one of those on the list. And why talk about feedback? Well, I thought it's a neat way to get a better understanding, but also food for thought for students to think about and make the link between feedback and climate change. So, as most of you know, ecosystems have this struggle between forces that resist change that we call negative feedback and those that promote change, and those are called positive feedback. So the ecosystem feedback is the effect that change in one part of an ecosystem has on another, and how this effect then feeds back to affect the source of the change, inducing more or less of it. Very important. Then, Remember, negative feedback loop is where one thing affects the other in the opposite direction. So in other words, that equals a stable system where these different forces counterbalance each other to create equilibrium. So there's a balance. Negative feedback provides stability, in other words. All ecosystems are composed of many negative feedback loops. So, for example, in population regulation that we've all learned in first year university. So basically, 100 years ago, before our man-induced changes and effects came into play, we were basking in negative feedback. And that's what was keeping things nicely stable. Now, for a positive feedback, what we need to remember is that it stimulates change, and that's what's responsible for the sudden appearance of drastic alterations in ecosystems. For example, the rapid annual temperature increase. So what's that having? It's a cascade effect, basically. So for example, spring spawning fish may spawn earlier, and the young of year, the larvae, emerge earlier, hatch before they typically do. Is zooplankton, or the food items that they need to prey on, upon exogenous feeding. So once their yolk sac is absorbed, they start feeding on the outside world and their environment. If that food isn't timed to be available, you can have an entire, what they call, recruitment or class failure, and all those young of year perish. So that happens several years in a row. Then species that they would have later in their adult life feed on become moribund. So this is just one small thing that I'm giving you an example of, but you get the idea how this has a domino effect, basically. So when part of a system increases, another part of the system also changes in a way that makes the first part increase even more. Now by increase, you can replace, let's say, change as well. So positive feedback is a source of instability and a strong force of change, as it can push the ecosystem outside of its normal operating range. And that is the essence of this sudden climate change that we're going through, and not the normal fluxes that we see between ice ages. So how does this then affect the future of our northern fisheries? Well, all species have limits of abundance, but these limits can fluctuate somewhat, or to a degree, I would say. There's no evidence really of large random variations in abundance among the various commercially important species, and that's very typical for northern, subarctic, and Arctic environments. So the stability in relative abundance of many species is proof that the carrying capacity for species in a particular ecosystem is stable. But we are seeing evidence that shifts in carrying capacity are occurring. So what does that mean? Well, if as a result of such a shift, the abundance declines and reaches a new equilibrium, meaning lower, let's say, rebuilding the fish stocks to the previous higher levels may not be possible. So then what? Well, sustaining a fishery is not necessarily maintaining a catch rate, which many fishers are used to, but maintaining what I call the optimal catch. In other words, something that's tuned in to the carrying capacity of that species under, of course, the status quo. Now, this is another reason why fisheries are often mismanaged, and this is why, with all due respect, I don't trust leaving commercial fishermen to set their own quotas. There's a lot of science that goes into these to assess what the carrying capacities are, how these change within a system, and how these quotas have to be often reset for, well, to adhere to the realities of current times. So if we have a decline in abundance that's a result of natural change in the carrying capacity and not due to overfishing, management actions would not be expected to rebuild abundance to their previous levels, and that's to the chagrin of commercial fishermen, of course, as an example. Okay. Okay, so, oops, sorry. about the future, in terms of these fisheries, we can sum up that lower catch levels, carrying capacity could still support a fishery, of course. And at that point, we can use traditional stock assessment approaches and establish quotas that would be lower than in the past. We have no choice. In other words, that's my way of saying face up to reality and time to conform to those new realities in terms of as a manager of these fisheries or these stocks. And the optimal catch, in this case, would ensure adequate spawning so that the population would increase when more favorable environmental conditions returned, if ever. But nonetheless, we have that flexibility, and that's the key. Okay, so now I want to go into, quickly, in the time I have left, a few examples of species that are most affected. So Arctic char, for example, short-lived anadromous, extensive ocean migrations, sometimes you encounter landlocked populations. Climate change will lead to very important indirect secondary effects. Remember, early on I mentioned how we're looking at the secondary effects when it comes to fish. There'll be a change to body condition and growth. In some areas, maybe they grow faster, larger. In some areas, they may lack food, and we can notice an overall average decrease in size. Change to their anadromous behavior, the timing of the runs, when are they coming in? These are usually very carefully synchronized to flow of streams as they enter from the marine environment into a freshwater environment. Loss of local biodiversity, of course, due to these habitat alterations. So it could be their food source, the other species that co-occur. But people of the local communities are basically going to have to adapt to these outcomes due to secondary effects. Next, lake trout. This is sort of the opposite. It's a very long-lived fish, restricted to freshwater in deep oligotrophic lakes, and it's a top predator where established. The range will likely become more northern restricted, so it has very particular requirements, and those, in this case, will push lake trout to occupy an even more northern distribution that they currently have. And fluvial populations may be more affected. Remember, some lake trout don't spawn in lakes, but actually enter streams to spawn. Those small streams are very easily impacted by changes such as an earlier spring, warming of water, etc. And then, one of the most interesting would be the Pacific salmon, which is a short-lived, anadromous, extensive ocean migrating fish. So they live in the ocean, they come into rivers to spawn. They actually are much more numerous in recent years. And there's a good Facebook website by a grad student doing her doctoral dissertation, Karen Dunmall, on Arctic salmon presence. And it's been known that chum salmon, for example, migrate up the Mackenzie, but their numbers have increased. And the diversity of salmon species, so not just chum, but pink, sockeye, chinook, all these species are now in the regular catch of fishers who are operating in the Mackenzie Delta. So this, of course, may impact the local poster boy fish, Arctic char, and they may end up competing for those limited resources in terms of spawning habitat and food availability. So models, a quick word about models. There's this famous example where researchers were looking at something that is a very southern fish, like smallmouth bass, restricted to the Great Lakes area, typically, and the Canadian-US border is its stronghold currently. And it's just neat to see how when you work with these models that can give you all these potential future scenarios, for example, they looked at the, in 13,000 lakes, summer surface water temperatures, and then they look of what these changes over time using different models and climate change scenarios gives, and bottom line, they saw that smallmouth bass are going to invade the Arctic by the year 2100. So again, a very specialized southern predator will establish its home in such northern waters. So closing final thoughts, really it's a new equilibrium that we should expect. There's going to be positive and negative feedbacks, which will be constantly in struggle and dictate the different changes to expect or what we will see in the fish fauna of the Arctic. Forced anadromy is something that we may see, so the landlocked char populations may find that those environments that they're in is too stressing or too warm, or certain food availability is no longer present, and they simply outmigrate to the sea. So you can see how the life history types even of fish may be altered by climate change. More Pacific salmon biomass in the Arctic waters. We're seeing it already, and that's going to have some major implications overall to the fish community balance. And the loss and gains to fisheries and local communities is something of an issue, because there are still many areas where fishers are reliant on a certain, well, what they're used to in terms of the abundance of certain species. Well, that's going to change. And remember, the final note, maybe I should say, the complexities in terms of model predictions are such that you can't necessarily rely on models, or that there's often more to it. And we're seeing that more and more as we go ahead with this. The models are a great way to predict possible scenario outcomes, but it's actually a very complex reality, and all components within the ecosystem need to be studied in depth. I hope I didn't go over time. Okay. Talk so fast.
Okay, thanks, Paul. We will have opportunities to ask Paul questions after Lois's presentation. So I'm going to go get her set up over here, and she can come up. Okay. Lois, we're going to move from the freshwater to marine, I would say.
Great. Well, thanks, Paul. That was great high-level theory.
So. I have to be all over the place.
Yeah, no, it's great, because what I have is very specific to some studies of certain marine mammals in the Beaupetit. I've been working up in the, shall I start? Or you, yeah,
whatever you're talking about.
I've been working with Fisheries and Oceans, federal department based out of Inuvik and now Yellowknife for what's going to be 25 years on Friday. And before that, I worked with the Inuvialuit up in the Inuvik region. So about 30 years of this. And when I first started, we would get a salmon now and then fall, and it was a big deal, and oh, and I used to, you know, deal with it. We'd get maybe one or two every couple of years, and now Karen has a deep freeze full from each year. So, I mean, it's really, even without a model or without all the extensive study, you can see these changes, and there's many, many changes. So my specialty is marine mammals, and as I said, working in Arctic marine ecosystem. The clicker here, that I figured this out now, just the side.
Yeah,
same that every time.
Yeah.
This is from an article by Henry Huntington. I provided a list of references. I hope you got them, and they're listed at the end of this talk. And, he cites, and I agree with, these are the sort of the six main stressors in the Arctic. Climate change being the first one he specifies, and the one that I'll be talking about today. And it's certainly one that we study and talk about and worry about. Number three, offshore oil and gas activity. When I started all this in the 80s, that was what we were, that's what we were working on and dealing with. And of course, that's changed. So that too fluctuates in cycles. This is a bowhead whale. Doing what it does, quite close to a support vessel for a seismic operation. So those are some of the things that we looked at in the past. The research that, is there like a point, is the pointer, I think it's the little, okay, let's try it. Okay, good. Broadly grouped, three types of marine mammal work we've been doing is area surveys, shore surveys, and things, and that's looking at populations. So how many there are across the region, pretty much. It's kind of a bird's eye view. We look at distribution and numbers. We've also done a lot of satellite tagging, where we live capture and attach satellite link transmitters to the back back of various marine mammal species. And that's really a different tool. We're looking at movements and activities of individuals. So the idea is to put these two things together. That one is a very exciting, sexy part of what we do. It's the sort of the drawback is there's so few. I mean, there's 20,000 bowhead whales, and we've spent almost 8 years and we've tagged 21. So it tells you a lot about what a few of them are doing, but so it's a combination. If there's time, I thought, because of this being a NASA Earth to Sky, I thought satellite tagging would be of interest. So I have a few slides in separately, but whether we have time or not. So now I'm going to talk about the main thing, which is some signals in that were actually changes we are seeing, not only the freezer full of salmon, but and that's that we sample animals that are harvested by our partners, the Inuvialuit in the Western Arctic. And as I'm sure you're all familiar, that's a subsistence harvest, and that's how they feed themselves. And so over a lifetime, several lifetimes, they're experts at sampling as fish, whales, seals. They're experts at picking up changes. They're experts at, I mean, they've got a lifetime of experience, which is quite different from when we come in and track a whale for a year or fly over over the Beaufort for an afternoon. So you can see that. And the things we can look at by working with our partners is the fatness of the of all the species that are coming in, the general health, reproduction, and diet. And those become linkages to how the ecosystem is doing. What kind of are they, what food they're eating, how they're doing, and is that changing? So the whole thing can kind of be summarized by saying this, you are what you eat. And as marine mammals change in their reproduction and body condition, it informs us as to what they've been, how things are in the ecosystem and what they've been eating. Basically, we focus on, I have a paper that's on five species, and it's over 20, 30 years of sampling. So it provides great sample sizes, great partnerships with local interpretations, and it's also very cost effective. The satellite tagging work, for example, will breaks the bank and you get your 21 whales, this kind of thing. We work together with communities sampling and are able to get these long-term statistically significant trends because we have samples that are large enough. I've been working mostly on marine mammals, also on Arctic char at three stocks. So just as Paul was saying, you're going to see changes in Arctic char, and we have done that. There's a seabird study I might touch on if I have time. And again, these are from subsistence harvested species. So basically, you kind of have to look at the Arctic food web and who eats who. I just want to talk about a couple of the players here. This is the ring seal. This is the one that I've been working on, a 25-year study. And the bowhead whale, Craig George and his group in Alaska, have been sampling bowheads since the 1980s. And the ring seal feeds on Arctic cod, which is right here in the middle. And if I had to say one species that is under known about and is the most important key ecosystem species, it's going to be the Arctic cod. You can see it's right in the middle. It feeds on all these lower trophic levels, and then all these upper level predators prey on it, except for the bowhead whale. And they are a baleen whale, and they are filter feeders, plankton feeders, and they feed on, actually they've got them feeding on krill here. They, this may be from the Eastern Arctic, but in the Western Arctic, it's these guys, the copepods. That's an Arctic cod up close, very nondescript. Communities don't really, they know about it, and they have names for it, but it's not a species that they harvest or eat. So it's a really important link for science to focus in on, because science has access to some of these keystones that you might not see if you were a harvester. And this is a close-up shot of a copepod. They're basically described as little balls of oil. lot of these to meet their annual energy requirements, of course. So the study at Point Barrow was bowhead whale. This is the Alaska. They have a harvest of bowhead whales here, which has been underway since the 70s. And they have a full staff in Point Barrow, including a veterinarian and samplers. And they have been looking when they harvest somewhere 30 to 50 a year, and they measure them. You've probably seen that on TV. We have a number of monitoring programs. Our sort of flagship one is Ring Seals. This is John Alakamic and his wife Emma. I've worked with them for 25 years. We've got four primary articles from this study, and of which he's an author on them, and he's won awards for this work. And it's definitely, it's based out of Ulutaktok, which is right here. So I'm only going to talk about these two. This is me and John and Emma a long time ago. They look the same, I do. And we've also sampling beluga whales and working with the people in the Mackenzie Delta. And I put this slide in. This is actually one of the tagging studies, but we tend to work with the Inuvialuit, and we have a much bigger local team than we do science team. It really only takes one or two scientists to make sure that all the scientific rigor is going to be brought to bear on the paper or a study. Like, we need to have a bigger sample or whatever kind of math or publication we're going to do, but these guys are the masters at skidoos and knowing where the seals are and all those things. So we recognize that in each other and we work together. Okay, now comes the, I've got one slide on bowhead data and then two on the ring seal data. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. So what's happening with these two species? You can read that paper and you can see about five. Craig George he's published up to 2011. This is the body condition index, the fatness, how being that if you're a whale and you're fat, you're doing well, you're getting lots to eat, that they've seen, I said this is a statistically significant increase in the body condition of subadult bowhead whales over time. And this goes up to 2011. This also trend occurs in adults, same thing, although it's not statistically significant. And we think that is probably because bowhead whales are the adults. They don't, like any natural population, the adults don't tend to fluctuate conditions as much as the subadults. It's kind of like the teenagers of the group. They have a harder time making a living, so they are the ones that show first when there's a drop. But just a reminder, they're eating the calanoid copepods. There's been a very separate study, increase in calf counts. So there's many more calves are spotted. So the population is appears to be realizing some improved reproduction. And also they have dedicated surveys of bowheads migrating over in spring, and the number in the stock has gone up. Some of you may know that this population was decimated by commercial whalers, and so you've got an increase from no commercial whaling anymore. So the population has recovered, although the bottleneck problems and the genetic limitations are part of that when you knock a population down so far. But so with the bowheads, we're seeing an increase in the population, increase in reproduction, increase in condition. So some people have published that bowhead whales, it's boom times. No way to say where that's going to go from here. Who knows? But the implication is, and if you talk to biological oceanographers, is that you've got an increase in primary and secondary production with climate change, that there's more food for them. So they're eating more, reproducing more.
How do you separate that out from what we were talking about before, where it's just that the baseline is too low? Harvesting.
You mean, you don't. You do, yeah. There's no way to, that I know of anyway, unless there's genetic, it just keeps, we can't say why.
So it's hard to, so like, what I'm asking is, can you say that it is because there's, I mean, the sort of conclusion you draw out of this, it's not necessarily just you, but they, you know, things are warmer, there's more of these copepods, and so the population is growing. It is, I mean, were they below the carrying capacity of the food source anyway, just by virtue of...
They were,
right.
Yeah, and then they're back up to it, and Craig George will say right now, they may be at carrying capacity right now, and they may be, and they, so this may plateau out, and it's very complex, and I'm not sure that I would be, that's what he said to me recently, he said we may be at carrying capacity.
So when was the decrease or the commercial whaling stopped? I mean, this is with Norway, Japan, like
Norway. No, this is the whalers from Seattle came up. This is in the Western Arctic, and they came up and they started at the Chukchi Sea in the 1800s, and then they just you know,
right.
Went further and further. And the last one taken in Canada, in Cape Bathurst area, was 1925. I remember Herschel Island, there was that, but it kind of was a wave.
Right,
yeah.
So the West.
And there was a lot of papers published on what the size used to be,
mm-hmm.
and I think it was around 20,000, and I think they're back up to that now. And this population was as low as 7,000, I believe, or 10, or 7 or 10, about 1980.
Okay.
So this is what good cooperation between hunters and science can produce. A settled land plant in the North Slope of Bertle. They have solid, they have jurisdiction. You know, it's not like the government coming in and say, okay, let's fly a survey. They actually do this together, and they've come a long way. I just got a paper at review right now, which is, we get dead bowheads washing up in the Beaufort region. And so I'm keeping track of those. And over the last 30 years, the rate of them washing up dead. It's like one or two a year. It's kind of no natural mortality idea. And some of them are really young, and some of them are really, really old. So it's kind of, it does suggest that senescent mortality perhaps at the other end of the scale. But we'll see if that changes over time, if it gets to carrying us. A lot of speculations. Okay, ring seals now. Now, this is me putting this in, fluctuating time. So bowheads are booming, ring seals are driving us crazy because they're up, they're fluctuating, and we really see that a lot. This is John and Emma, and they've sampled over 2,500. Now that seems like a lot of seals, but it's about 100 a year. Same guy sampling in the same place with the same ruler and the same skills at sampling, and that gives us a lot of confidence in our data because we don't have, or that allows us to control for measuring biases. So we've got these papers from this, and we have data going back to the 70s from one of the collaborators, Tom Smith. But this is just showing reproduction in ring seals. So over all these years, ring seals tend to ovulate at between 80 to 100% of the time, and that's pretty normal. And that's the expected rate of ovulation we get in females. What we've found is that in three times in all these years, 74, 2005, and 2012, there was a failure of reproduction. What that means is the females were conserving resources for survival, and they were thinner because it must have been tough times in that year. And so they, instead of eating to get put on weight, they didn't have the resources to ovulate or bring off a pup, so or have a pregnancy. So, but then they would always recover back. So that's what we're seeing. This is ring seals, this fluctuations. I haven't got time or data today to talk about these three failures. These two were associated with really, really heavy ice conditions. And in those years, might have been not enough food, might have been working so hard at staying, keeping a territory and staying, surviving in the ice in those years, that they decided they made the biological choice not to ovulate. This one was really interesting because it was the lightest ice year on record. So So we're starting to see the seals are reacting to these extremes, perhaps, rather than just the really heavy days. Okay, now the other thing we look at is body condition, and so John has measured the fatness. There's five different measurements from 2,500 seals over these 25 years, and when we look at the data, this is what we had through 2010. And it was a long-term slow decline in seal condition over time. And I also mentioned we saw the same thing in beluga. And this is, again, opposite to what we were just talking about for bowheads. So just like belugas, ring seals, Arctic cod, remember that. So it raises the question, are there changes in Arctic cod? So then I've added on the last few years that we've got. So this is why I'm thinking we're seeing they have a capacity to recover, or we see a reversal in these trends. The Inuit hunters, when you talk to them, what they'll say when they enter, oh, well, they've adapted, they're eating something else. And John will say, oh yes, well, there's no Arctic cod anymore in our near shore waters. No, we don't. They are feeding on sand, those other ones, sandland. That's what we get, and that's for working together. I think this is my lab getting, am I going way over? Okay. So it suggests that there's been shifts in the prey of both the bowheads and the ring seals. Very hard to quantify. Think of 100 seals sampling the marine environment, or hundreds of Arctic char every season. And when we sample that, what we're getting to look at. When you think of a large research vessel that goes offshore and spends megabucks to sample, and they get to sample, they might drop nets in 30 stations. That's why this is such a great tool. The marine mammals and the fish do the work for them. So Tom Smith, back from the 70s, he got some Arctic char stomach content. The reason I'm showing this is that the seals and the char feed the same area in the summer. And in the 70s, this is what the Arctic char were eating in the ocean, in the near shore waters in summer. It was over 93% or more of Arctic cod. This is a mysid, and this, which is a small crustacean that's near the seafloor. And this is Onesimus glacialis, and that is an ice-associated amphipod. So, working with a biologist from Inuvik now, her name is Alan Lee, she's very, very insightful on how all these things work. He got some stomachs from Arctic char, and this is 2014-2015, and this is what those char in the same area, how many years, 30 years later, were feeding on. And it really changed. We see a few Arctic cod, and we still see these mysid, and those were the only two that were the same. This is a polychaete worm, and this is the new one here, it's sandlands. And you might have heard of capelin and sandlands, they're recolonization, or moving in as things shift and change. And the sandlands, the belugas, were found with stomachs full of sandlands. And John will say, oh, the seals, they feed. It's not cut and dry, but we can see these shifts evolving. This one is Themisto, Parathemisto, it's a type of amphipod. Some of you, I think, are from the north. You might have seen in Politec last year, there was a blanket of these things, millions of them washed up on the shore. So we identified them, they were this Themisto, and now around Politec, the seals, he says, oh, you talk to the hunters from Politec, oh, they feed on, that's what we get, that's what the seals are feeding on now. I asked the zooplankton people, well, it's not going to decimate these Themisto population that they all, a whole bunch of them washed up, but it certainly is unprecedented, is what the zooplankton folks said. So again, changes, 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 we're seeing that. And what so what's happened to the Arctic cod? We don't know. Maybe it's a fluctuation. Perhaps there are less of them. I'm not going to get into all the biology of Arctic cod. Very little is known about it, and it's very complicated, and they're very diverse. They do like to be associated with the ice, so I tend to think that it's not that they are, there's less of them, but perhaps they're retreating with as the ice retreats. Okay, so this is the responses, or the take-home message, and it's that the responses of the different species are not linear, and they're not easily predicted. We see how when you have these long-term data sets, you can see things fluctuating. They're not the same in different areas, seasons, and species. You can pick up a ring seal paper from somewhere else and something like Norway or something like that, where they also study, you can see quite different. We have, over the last 25 years, we've seen emerging changes in body condition, both positive and negative, and also evidence of reversals and changes in potential changes in diet. And that is what the hunters that I work with say, oh, well, they're eating something else now. And so that's the adaptation. Whether those sand lamps are, well, they're not as nutritionally, they have lower fat content than Arctic cod sand lamps do, but by about 5% lipid content. So whether that translates into something. And so we're seeing linkages to sea ice, but also linkages to changes in prey. It's very important to substantiate and monitor trends in marine mammals. You might appreciate when we started this, there was very, it was a hard sell back in 25 years ago, you know, it really was, and so now it's not a hard sell anymore, but, and it requires a long-term commitment and support of money. Basically, you can do satellite tag program for 5 years, you can't sort of embark on this just to do it for a few years, because you can see it's gonna wreak havoc on your interpretation. And one of my personal real concerns is the you need to do it so it's scientifically sound, and then get out of it a publication that's peer reviewed and it can be used to affect policy, or that it can be circulated. Not everybody wants to monitor, right? If it's not designed properly and done over a long term, you end up with a lot of binders on the shelf of monitoring data. It's really important to anticipate before that comes up. Monitoring also, you got to be ready for surprises that are going to come out and be able to respond to them and detect them. And ultimately, I think this type of work will get towards looking at the factors that actually cause this, or at least inform sort of maybe oceanographic studies that would be looking at the reasons why. There's one of Deanna's photos right there. So that's it, and then here's the reading list, which there's a number of really good papers, and I think most of them, the seal and the whale paper are captured there, but there's five or six papers that summarize putting all this together by a number of different authors, and I would urge you to read them, because they do all the synthesis for you. Okay, so I apologize if I went on to you.
In close, I'd like to invite Paul. Would you like to come up to the front?
I have one question, and then I'll come up to the front.
Okay.
So that Arctic char dietary shift, okay, interesting. But really what I want to know, and what I hope, and I guess you folks have thought of, is to compare length and age. What's the difference?
Yes, well, I only presented a couple of slides, right? So
okay, so
yes,
in like 2 seconds, what's the difference in length and age?
Improvement.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, improvement in Arctic char. Yes.
So what she's saying is, at, let's say, age 12, a typical ocean-residing Arctic char will actually be a bit bigger than it was now than it was in 1977.
Well, just to qualify that, the data we have on size of char goes back to 1990. We have every year all the way up to now. And then we do have 77 and 78, but to look at a long-term improvement, 1990.
So. Interesting. So we have questions for clarification, or if you want to know more about something?
There was one thing, and I was very strictly adhering to my time limit. Therefore, I didn't dare go into a very quick little story that I want to take, if you all don't mind, 1 minute on. So when I was on the slide of the Arctic char, the photo I had showed an Arctic char in very shallow water. I took that photo, I took all the photos. And this summer, I actually spent half a month up near Kugluktuk at the old dew line site, northwest of Kugluktuk. And I went with a few elders as well, who actually have decades of history in that area. And the small river we were on at Bernard Harbor, it was pointed out to me that in areas where we were now standing in ankle-deep water were for decades, as far back as they can remember, waist-deep. The actual flow in the summer has so decreased that the char that typically used to run in late August to go up and spawn now have to tune into that and try to catch, imagine this, the freshet in early summer, if they even have a chance in hell to get up to where they need to go. So that's one dramatic thing. Next, the actual temperature while I was there went up to 21 degrees Celsius. Now that's deadly for Arctic char, almost. While we were looking at the adults migrating upstream, we had a fish trap set across the river, and we would also be catching the out-migrating young fish. They're not young of year, they're like 2-3 years old. They reside in the lake for a few years and then out-migrate to sea to become big guys, and then they come back. So get this, so these out-migrating little guys, every morning we would open up the trap and I would see 100, 200, and we would put a dip net in the water, scoop them up. Now in the trap, they're not drowning because they're facing upstream and the flow is going over them and they're ventilating. So they're holding in the trap. But as I scoop them up and I don't even lift them out of the water, but I walk with the flow to release them over the other side of the trap, those 5 seconds where my dip net is moving at the same speed as the river flow, they all start turning upside down. The stress is so immense that unless they're hyperventilating, facing upriver, that's what happens. They could die in a second like that. So it's so precarious, the existence of that stock, whether adult or juvenile, it's like on the razor's edge. It's really a stressed modern environment. And, you know, there are certain trends like the isostatic rebound, which we know about, and there are decade-type fluctuations. But it seems, especially speaking to some of the older people in town, that recently there have been extremes like no one has in human history experience. And at least I got to see some of it. But it can be pretty dramatic. It's not always just where science and graphs and stuff shows the change. You can experience sometimes some of this. And I thought it's a neat practical example for people to take home.